Alleluia, sing to Jesus, He's the scepter, He's the throne. Alleluia, He's the triumph, He's the victory alone. Hark the songs of peaceful Zion, thunder like a mighty flood. Jesus, out of every nation, hath redeemed us by His blood. Alleluia, not as orphans are we left in sorrow now. Alleluia, He is near us, faith believes, no questions out. Though the clouds from Zion received Him, when the 40 days were o'er, shall our hearts forget His promise? I am with you evermore. Alleluia, bread of heaven, you on earth are food. Alleluia, hear the sinful plead to you from day to day. Intercessor and a sinner's earth redeemer, plead for me. Where the songs of all the sinless sweep across the crystal sea.
Morning. How's everybody doing? Great. I heard a couple greats, a couple silences, but it is good to be here with you this morning. It's great to be back. I wanted to thank all of you for praying for the senior high as we went up to New Hampshire on our missions trip. We brought everybody back, so that's always a good thing, and it was a great week, great trip. The kids served really, really well. I was told by the camp up there that they basically had a to-do list for us, a wish list for us, and a dream list for us to get accomplished, and the teens were able to get all the way through the dream list, and so they served well. They deserve a hand, a round of applause, yes, they did excellent work. They represented Berean Bible Church very well, but more importantly, they represented the Lord Jesus Christ in a great way, as they had a great servant's heart this week. So the trip was amazing. So thank you for your prayers. They were much appreciated. And it's good to be back with you all. And then just a couple announcements here this morning as we begin. The first is kids ministry is growing, and we are in need of help. And that comes in kind of two different phases. The first is there's an immediate need. You can see those up on the screen. Also, Paul and Betsy Filippi will be in the back. They're here in the back. There's a green cardstock ministry on the table back there. You can find them if you're interested in signing up. There's also future needs as we head back to one service and go to Sunday school hour. Again, we have been blessed with a growing number of children, but that is a good problem to have. But now we need those of you to step up and serve in a big way. There's a lot of hands needed for the children's ministry. That comes through teachers and helpers, things like that. If you're interested in that, I would strongly encourage you to pray about this and see if this is a place that the Lord wants you to serve in. But we are in big need of some help. So our prayer is that you would be willing to step up and take the reins here and fill in where needed. Again, you can see Paul and Betsy. They'll be back at this back table here at the end of the service. Again, you see some of the needs listed up on the screen. There are immediate needs and future needs needed as well that are coming. And then Promotional Sunday will be happening on September 12th. This is where the kids move up. Teachers will be recognized. The kids, for those of you who know, who have been coming to Berean, the kids have Bible verses to memorize each month. The kids will get a reward for that. So be on your kids to get those verses recited. It's an awesome thing. Hopefully you've been doing that, but if not, that is the deadline, you know, to have those verses recited. So that is coming up here on September 12th. And then August 12th, our Cornerstone Young Adult Group will be having a worship night at Sanatoga Park. That's this week. That will take the place of their normal meeting on Thursday nights. That'll be happening at 6:30 p.m. again at Sanatoga Park. That's free. So if you are a young adult or know of young adults, invite them on out to that. That's a free night, and it's going to be a great night of worship there with our young adult group. And then August 22nd, we will be doing our annual church picnic. Also, very, very important for you to sign up. Sign-ups will be in the back. Kelly Lynch and Earl will be, or maybe just Kelly, I don't know. One of the Lynches will be back there signing you up. It's very important. We need to know how much food to make. So it is imperative that you sign up, you and your family. We know the number. There's going to be a lot of great food, pulled chicken, hot dogs, sausages. There's going to be great food. We always eat well here at Berean, so we just need to know how much food to prepare for. Or how many people to prepare for. And then also bring your swimming suits. It'll be right after church down here at the pool at the end of the drive. That'll be at 12:30. And it's going to be a great afternoon of fellowship and fun. So we'd love to have you join us there on August 22nd. And now also Feed My Starving Children will be on the 25th of December. Those of you who know, we've hosted that the last several years back here in the gym. There's also a table back there, some containers to put change in. If you have spare change money in, you can fill that out. You can join us to serve as we pack food to send to children around the world. It's a great event, and so please stop by the back table there and find out more information on that. And then also our ladies ministry, our Joy Builders will be heading to the March for Life, and so if you're interested in that, there is the information there on the slide for that. That is September 27th that will be happening. And then our last announcement this morning is choir will be starting on September 19th. If you're interested in joining choir, if you love to sing, we'd love to have you join our choir. Please see Julie Dawson over here or Nick. You can talk to one of them. That's coming up here rather quickly. And then also handbells will be starting the first Thursday in October. And if you're interested in that, please see Julie Dawson again over here. She said it's crucial that you talk with her, though, in the next week or two if you're interested in that, in joining the handbells. So there's a lot of stuff coming up, a lot of stuff to sign up for. So we'd encourage you, to get involved, sign up, and, be a part of what God is doing here at Berean. And so it's good to have you again with us, and I will turn it over to Nick and the worship team.
I'm excited to hear about that for choir and handbells. You know why? Because that means that things are getting back to normal. So looking forward to the end of the year where we're all back together in one service, and we can barely fit everybody here as it is, so that's going to be fun. Well, let's start with a word of prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you for the wonderful gift of salvation that none of us deserve, but you give so freely. Sending your Son to die on the cross for our sins, bringing forgiveness. On that cross, all the sins were paid for. And that blood is applied, that atonement is applied to those who believe in you. There are no powers of darkness that can overtake us, but instead, the Lord of hosts, the God of angel armies, fights for us, and he's already won the battle. We thank you for being a magnificent, magnificent, strong God, one who has authority over all aspects of the universe. Not a drop falls from the sky unless it is allowed by heaven. So as we praise you today, we remember that we serve an almighty, sovereign God who is over all, through all, and in all. If we simply believe. In Jesus' name, amen. Our scripture for today comes from Luke chapter 11. Jesus was driving out a demon that was mute. When the demon left, The man who had been mute spoke, and the crowd was amazed. But some of them said, "By Beelzebul, the prince of demons, he is driving out demons." Others tested him by asking for a sign from heaven. Jesus knew their thoughts and said to them, "Any kingdom divided against itself will be ruined, and a house divided against itself will fall. If Satan is divided against himself, how can his kingdom stand? I say this because you claim that I drive out demons by Beelzebul. Now, if I drive out demons by Beelzebul, by whom do your followers drive them out? So then, they will be your judges. But if I drive them out demons by the finger of God, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. When a strong man, fully armed, guards his own house, his possessions are safe. But when someone stronger attacks and overpowers him, he takes away the armor in which the man trusted and divides up his plunder. Whoever is not with me is against me, and whoever does not gather with me scatters. When an impure spirit comes out of a person, it goes through arid places seeking rest and does not find it. And then it says, 'I will return to the house I left.' When it arrives, it finds the house swept clean and put in order. Then it goes and takes seven other spirits more wicked than itself, and they go in and live there. And the final condition of that person is worse than the first." Jeff will be preaching about that a little later, but for now we just want to focus on how Jesus is indeed the king over all, and he can command the demons to flee, and he breaks the powers of darkness. So we're going to hail the glorious Christ. Please stand as we sing.
Above the earth and heaven's angels, over kings and all their plans, when every rival throne is fallen, you will stand, you will stand. All hail the glorious Christ, oh praise the Lord of life, for by your sacrifice you won the victory. Now over all you reign, you overwhelm the grave, and rose again on high. All hail the glorious Christ. Temptations, your great love has overcome, defeating death and condemnation. You have won, you have won.
Let's sing it loud.
All hail the glorious Christ, oh praise the Lord of life, for by your side you won the victory. Now over all you reign, you overwhelm the grave, and rose again on high. All hail the glorious Christ. On that day upon your mountain, you will gather your redeemed, and we will feast and give our glory to the King, to the King. And on that day upon your mountain, you
Last night I was driving home from State College. I was leading worship out there, and it was nighttime. It was already dark. My way back, and as I was, I didn't take the turnpike because I'm cheap, and so I was taking some highways. I don't remember what they were anymore, but they were headed straight towards the foothills, and as I was looking at them, just trying to keep forward, trying to stay awake, all of a sudden, there started to be these white flashes in the sky. And then they would get, like, worse and worse, and they'd kind of follow a rhythm. But then they would stop. And so I was trying to go, you go through your mind, like, all the things you remember in your life that does that. Okay, so is it thunder? Is it lightning? No, I don't hear any thunder. Is it one of them stupid lights they put in a car lot? No, it's not doing this. So I was trying to figure out what this was, but the road had me driving right towards it, and there was no way to turn around. And all of a sudden, it kept getting worse and worse to the point where it was flashing and flashing, and then the entire sky lit up without a sound. And so, like, as it builds up, you don't know what it is. The thrill continues to build, too. And I never did find out what it was. I didn't. Yeah. But some folks that were at the last service, they said, yeah, we were out there, too, and we don't know what it was either. But as I was viewing it, you know, in mystery and excitement, all I could think of was, I wonder what it'll be like when Jesus comes back. And when I say that, I'm not talking about the rapture. See, we know what it's like at the rapture, that he calls us to the sky, to the clouds, and we'll meet him there, and it'll change us. I'm talking about for those who have not accepted him, do not believe, and instead are left here through the tribulation. At the end, Jesus comes back as the Lord of hosts. How terrible a sight. If you know him as your king, it's a wonderful thing, knowing that he is for you and there is no power that can stand against him. But if he is not your king, instead you live your life in defiance of him. It is a terrible thing to think the God of all creation coming down from the clouds, bringing a mighty host behind him on the horses to wreak havoc and destruction on the earth of which you are a part of. It's terrifying. The truth is, we get that choice. A lot of us are new. They've been visiting for the past couple months now. And I don't want us to think that just because we all started coming to this church, we're all the same spot. I want you to understand that we have to decide to follow after him, to accept that gift, so that instead of being a general, a commander of an army against us, he can be our protector and guardian. Every single one of us is a sinner and in need of salvation. If you're listening today online, I want you to understand this too. Jesus died on the cross for your sins and rose again from the dead. If you believe in that, you have eternal life. It's that simple. You confess that with your mouth. Believe that Jesus Christ rose from the dead, confessing with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and you shall be saved. For by grace you have been saved. It is a gift of God, not by yourselves, not of works, lest any man should boast. I don't care how good you've been. You've probably been a lot better person than I am. It's not that hard. But the truth is, I know I get to go to heaven because of his grace and his love and his forgiveness and salvation. And because of that, I get to call him my Lord of hosts, and he is my protector. So we're going to sing this song. We started learning last week, Lord of Hosts. Oh, come behold the works of God, the nations at his feet. He breaks the bow and bends the spear and tells the wars to cease. O mighty one of Israel, you are on our side. We walk by faith in God who burns the chariots with fire. Lord of hosts, you're with us. With us in the fire, with us as a shelter, with us in the storm. You will lead us through the fiercest battle. Oh, where else would we go with the Lord of hosts? Oh, God of change, fierce and great, you lift your voice to speak. The earth that bows and all the mountains move into the sea. Oh Lord, you know the hearts of men, and still you let them live. Oh God, who makes the mountains melt, come wrestle us and win. Oh God, who makes the mountains melt, come wrestle us and win. Lord of hosts, you're with us in the fire, with us as a shelter, with us in the storm. You will lead us through the fiercest battle. Oh, the Lord of all, the one who calms the winds and waves.
waves and makes my heart be still. Though the earth gives way, the mountains move into the sea, and the nations reach, I know my God is in control. The oceans roar, you are the Lord of all, the one who calms the wind and waves and makes my heart be still. Though the earth gives way, the mountains move into the sea, the nations wait, I know my God is in control. Lord of hosts, you're with us.
Displayed. Father, we thank you for him. We look forward to the day that he comes back again and brings us to himself. We thank you for your love and your grace that has brought us together as a body of Christ, not just in this local assembly, but across the world and across time. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
Well, good morning, church. Hey, did me or did Nick just confess to seeing a UFO? I think maybe we're going to have a talk with him afterwards. You know, you might want to
might want to see them. Although I noticed that, you see, like, if you're here for both services, you get to see the subtle changes. Like, because I called him out on this in the first service, and in this one he inserted, oh, and other people saw it too, so I'm not the only, like, way to cover yourself, buddy, got you right there, that was nice. But, you know, speaking about strange occurrences, on October 30th, 1938, a group of radio voice actors, including a young Orson Welles, gathered in a New York studio and prepared to do an adaptation of H.G. Wells' science fiction novel, The War of the Worlds. Now, in this classic book, it tells the story of an alien invasion of planet Earth for the purpose of enslaving and destroying humanity. Now, the radio broadcast was so realistic and so convincing and done in such a way that people believed that it was true. The police were inundated with reports of people panicking in the streets, exhibiting signs even of mass hysteria. Now, while the news media exaggerated the story, not that they ever do that. See, times haven't changed all that much, right? And even though the story was probably exaggerated to a great degree, there were definitely some who were genuinely fooled by the program that evening. Now, there's a great irony here that we have to point out. For in 1938, a group of people truly believed that an otherworldly enemy invaded the planet for the purpose of killing and enslaving humanity. Now, imagine how foolish those people felt when they found out the truth. And history records them as being so foolish as to being fooled, I mean, by this program. Yet consider the vast billions of people that have lived on planet Earth over the centuries, never knowing that that very thing had indeed happened for real. Think about it. Think about the message of the scripture. That Satan, the devil, was once an angel. We know that he worshiped God until the day that he came, desired his own throne. That he desired, you mean, the worship that belongs rightly only to God himself. And he declared that he would set up his own throne, that it would become his own ruler. And he rebelled against God. Well, God cast him out of heaven, down to the earth. Where he convinced Adam and Eve to join in his rebellion against God. And so because of this, he became, the scripture tells us, the God of this age. In Ephesians, the prince of the power of the air. And another place that the whole world is under the control, or the whole world system is under the control, I mean, of the evil one. And since the dawn of creation, he has been enslaving and destroying mankind. What are his tools? Hatred, addiction, violence, seduction, division, and the list goes on and on and on. Who knew? Who would have thought? Who could have conceived that there really has been a war of worlds going on in the spiritual realm between God and Satan? That's the idea behind our message this morning from Luke chapter 11, verses 14 through 26. We're going to see this war of the worlds play out for us before our very eyes in this story, and it's wonderful, and I hope you're ready. So let's get your Bible out and turn there. I want you to see this. It is Berean Bible Church. I hope you brought your Bible to church. You need to bring it. You can have it with you so you can look this up. Make sure I'm telling you the truth this morning. But God's Word is incredible. We're going to unpack the story one verse at a time. Let's dive in here, verse 14. We read these words. Jesus was driving out a demon that was mute. And when the demon left, the man who had been mute spoke, and the crowd was amazed. Now, this is, you know, pretty incredible setup here. Remember that throughout the course of our study in Luke, we've been talking to you about the fact that Jesus has been doing things that no one else was able to do. That he was performing special miracles that we called messianic miracles. Pastor Jace began this idea when he talked about the fact that Jesus was able to heal a man with leprosy. And you remember that in all the history of the Jewish faith and all the writings of the rabbis, I mean, down through the centuries, There was no Jewish person who was ever able, no Jewish Pharisee, no Sadducee, no religious leader, no scribe, no rabbi who was able to cure a man with leprosy. That was a miracle that was seen as only the Messiah will be able to do that one day. And here comes Jesus who shows up on the scene and performs that very miracle. We have another one of those here in this passage. Okay? We read here that Jesus is driving out a demon. And by the way, the word for a driving out actually comes in secular Greek from the realm of wrestling. Those of you that are wrestling fans out there, it literally means to throw down, to cast down. That's what Jesus is doing. He's just literally throwing down the demons out of this guy, right? And the scripture tells us very clearly that the demon was mute, unable to speak, and that the man was most likely unable to speak as well. Now, remember that previously in a message that I had done on a similar topic, that we had talked about the fact, that the Jews had a formula for casting out, a demon out of a person. And there were Jewish exorcists, rabbis that went around doing this. This was their entire ministry. And so they would go to the person who was demonized. They would establish contact with the demon within the person. And once they established that contact, they would attempt to find out the demon's name. And once they knew the demon's name, they would use the greater name of Yahweh, the greater name of God, to be able to cast out the lesser name, of that demon. And that's what they did. And that's how just about every Jewish exorcism went. That was the formula. So what do you do when the demon is mute and keeping the man from speaking as well? When there's no contact to be established? When you can't find out the name of the demon? That's why this was impossible except for Messiah. And wouldn't you know it, on this particular occasion, Jesus is walking along, and all of a sudden, here he encounters a demonized man who is mute. And he drives, out this demon, casts it out, throws it down. Look at the response of the crowd. Notice the crowd says that they are absolutely, utterly amazed. Greek word here means to stand in wonder, in awe. Dumbfounded is a good translation. In the parallel passage in Matthew chapter 9, or in a similar event, we read these words, that nothing like this has ever happened before in Israel. That's what the people who saw this miracle said. Nothing like this has ever happened before. Jesus is doing things that only the Messiah could do. And it was plain and it was obvious. Now, the story begins to turn here a little bit in verse 15. Let's read. But some of them said, by Beelzebul, the prince of demons, he is driving out demons. And others tested him by asking for a sign from heaven. Now, remember where we are in Jesus' ministry. It's always important to get the context of any passage that you read. Remember that we're in the final months of Jesus' life. Remember that the Gospel of Luke is back-ended. We have a majority of the information in that very short period surrounding his death, burial, and resurrection. And so here, we're not, early on in Jesus' ministry, like the chapter numbers might suggest, but we are late in Jesus' ministry. He's moving to Jerusalem. The heat is beginning to get turned up. We see the opposition beginning to grow. Early on, Jesus is very popular because he's healing and curing and setting free exactly what he said he was going to do when he quoted from the scroll of Isaiah. I'm here to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor, to bring release to captives, to set the prisoners free, to heal the sick and give sight to the blind. Remember that? He's doing all that. And the people are rejoicing. They're amazed at his miracles. But now, most likely because of the Jewish lies and opposition that are coming, and as they are approaching Jerusalem, so they're getting closer to the center of Jewish power, what's taking place now is there's an opposition from some in the crowd. Notice it only says some. But some of them begin saying, by Beelzebub, the prince of demons, you're driving out these demons. Now, let me paraphrase this for you. You're not driving out these demons by the power of God. You're doing it by the power of Beelzebub. Now, what about this whole name, Beelzebul? Where does this come from? Well, it's got a long history. It goes all the way back into Canaanite false religion. And some over the years have suggested a translation of this to something akin to the Lord of the Flies, or the Lord of the Dunghill, and the two go together because where there's a dunghill, there's also flies. And so the two are sort of the same. If we take the words literally and we apply to that standard as well, the Jewish rabbi's understanding of the term, we get a meaning that arrives something like this, the Lord of the house. Okay, the Lord of the house. Now, that's going to be significant. I want you to remember that, right? So you got that, stuff that back in the memory box. That's going to come back to us, in a little bit. So this is the Lord of the house. Notice they say here, the prince of demons. Well, who's the prince of demons? Well, that's Satan himself. Remember that? You mean the angelic world? I mean both the both the holy and the unholy exist in a hierarchy. Satan, you mean, is the head of all of the fallen angels, and then there's a hierarchy that extends from him, almost like a military rank structure. And so this is the chief of demons, the head of demons, the lord of the house of demons, Beelzebub. That's who they say. You're doing these things by the power of Beelzebul. And notice others in the crowd are saying, show us a sign that this isn't from the power of Satan, but it's from the power of God. We want to hear a voice from heaven. We want to see, some kind of, some proof, that you're not doing these things by, the power, of the devil himself. Now, wow. Let's just unpack this, for a minute. The miracle that Jesus had just done was undeniable, just like all of his miracles. He didn't do it in a closet somewhere where nobody saw it. A lot of modern-day miracles are being reported. No one sees them, even though in a day and age of cell phones, no cell phone ever captures it. There's no evidence of any of it, right? But here, Jesus' ministries are done, miracles are done in public, they're done openly, all the world can see. And the truth is beyond question. And these folks are so hardened in their hearts that they say to him, yeah, you did it, but you didn't do it by the power of God. You did it by the power of the devil. That's their argument, okay? Now, let me ask you this. Have you ever ran into a person who said something like this, either an unbeliever, sometimes even I hear Christians say this, I would be more apt, to have more faith in God or to believe in God if he were just to appear and do some sort of, miracle for me. Then I would believe, right? Why doesn't God do that today? Duh, he did it already, right? He's already been here. He already showed up. He's already done undeniable miracles. You are reading the story just as the people were participating in the story. You have the same choice. Now, this leads to an important point. Listen to me. Hear this. Unbelief is not a matter of the mind and a matter of evidence. Because the Bible is very clear that it is self-evident that God exists. The Bible says it's so self-evident that in Proverbs it says the fool says in his heart, there is what? There is no God. Creation makes it plain. The wonder of your body makes it plain. The accident of life on this planet, how unique and special, and the fine-tuning of the universe makes it undeniable that God has made the human race. It's clear. But Romans tells us this, that although God made it plain to them, although the truth is out there, it's undeniable, what people do with that, what unbelievers do with that truth, is they willfully suppress that knowledge that they have. Read it, Romans chapter 1. And they refuse to know God and they refuse to glorify him as God. Because they don't want to believe. Because believing comes with what? With some strings attached. With some things I have to give up. With some life change that I have to do. With some humbling of myself and acknowledging of my need of the gospel. And so rather than humble and bow the knee to God, the crutch of the universe, all those, ultimately strong people who say that, oh, I'm so strong, I don't need religion, that's a crutch for the weak. Yeah, whatever, bro. No, but we have to understand that it's not a lack of evidence, that miracles don't necessarily create faith. It's an act of the will. People know the truth about God, they choose not to believe it. Because of the hardness of man's heart. Now, moving on to verse 17. Look at this, another illustration here that Jesus is God, a little hint at it. Jesus knows their thoughts. And he says to them, any kingdom divided against itself will be ruined, and a house divided against itself will fall. If Satan is divided against himself, how can his kingdom stand? Let me paraphrase his words for you like this. If Satan casts out his own demons, then he's actively working against himself. And if he's actively working against himself and the advancement of his own kingdom, then how is his kingdom going to stand? How is it not going to collapse? Because he's literally working to tear it down. What Jesus is pointing out here is the absurdity of the argument.
You're doing it by the power of the devil.
Why would the devil cast out demons? It doesn't make any sense. It's stupid. It's ridiculous. It's foolish. And we see that same stupidity in the unbelieving world, that same willful blindness that says, I refuse to bow the knee to Jesus, and I will turn aside and believe anything else, however ridiculous, if it keeps me away from this God who has that expectation on my life. That's where we're at. That's where the human race has been. It's where we continue to be. We get into the realm of the absurd, and we're there now as a nation. Satan's kingdom can't stand if it's divided against himself, and the two words here are great. The word ruined here means destroyed, laid waste, or made desolate. The word for fall here means collapse or be thrust down. Now, if these words sounded all familiar to you, a house divided against itself cannot stand. They sound familiar because they have a really amazing historical usage as well. They were used by none other than Abraham Lincoln in 1858 when he gave his House Divided speech. Now, you can look this up online and get the full context of his speech. But it was really, you know, pretty amazing. He was running for Senate, the Republican Senate seat. He was going against Stephen Douglas, I mean, at the time, and the major issue that was plaguing the country was slavery. And this is the full quote, you know, from Lincoln when he used, I mean, this scripture. He said this, a house divided against itself cannot stand. I believe this government cannot endure permanently, half slave and half free. Now, that part, you know, we got, right? But I want you to see the next part, because the next part is critical, and it's maybe a little different than maybe we thought we understood about his quote, about his statement here, his speech. He said, I do not expect the Union to be dissolved. He didn't believe that America would cease to be America. It would just, you know, fall apart. He didn't believe that. But notice what he says. I do not expect the house to fall, but I do expect that it will cease to be what? Divided. That it will become one thing, or all one thing, or all the other. In other words, what Lincoln knew is that someone was going to win that battle. That someone was going to be victorious. Now, the nation was divided into the Republican, pro-abolitionist North and the Democratic, pro-slavery South. Now, ultimately, we know historically, that the North won the argument. Took a civil war, some pain and, a couple hundred thousand deaths, to work that out. But eventually, we were able to recognize that evil, and begin to move beyond it. But Lincoln's quote, is incredibly prophetic because, we're going through, this sort of same thing today. If I were the president of the country and I would be giving what we call the State of the Union address that the president gives you every year, I would say that we're a house divided as well. You agree? We see this, being brought to the forefront, in our nation. That those, that lead us, those who influence our culture, have the goal of bringing division to the United States of America in almost every issue of the day. We see it over immigration. We see it over gender, divide by sex, divide by race, divide by socioeconomic class, even divide back by vaccines. Now, why? Why is it that there are wedges being driven into almost every important issue in American life? Is it just something that sort of, happened by accident? Is there something behind this? I mean, folks, remember, we're in a war of the worlds. How does this relate to our Christian faith? Let's take a look for a second. From a human standpoint, there are those, in the country, that believe that they need to tear down America's institutions, America's history, America's heritage, to remake it into a more equitable society. Now, when you read that, it means, communist or socialist. That's the idea. That's the plan. We're going to remake America. So to everyone, you mean, we'll share equally in this new society, that everyone will be equal, equitable. That's the idea. In fact, you saw this. I mean, I was absolutely, absurdity. I was absolutely stunned. I mean, when I heard folks, when they were still, undergoing the rebellions in Cuba and speaking out and marching and protesting and desiring, freedom, there were people who defended Cuba by saying, well, Cuba's really actually a great country because there's the closest, it's the closest gap of income inequality in any nation in the world. I mean, the difference between the rich and the poor is so close in that country, and so therefore it's a great country. I'm like, well, yeah, you know why it's so close? Because they all have nothing. That's the thing. Folks want to make everyone equally miserable as we move toward a globally equitable society. Now, take a look at that, and then go behind that and take a look at what's happening at a cosmic or spiritual level. We know that the scripture predicts that one day Satan, through the Antichrist, will be the head over a one-world government. We know that for a fact. The Bible predicts that. We see that movement continuing to gain strength. There are those that are looking for, this great reset after COVID. By the way, if we ever actually get past it, which I don't think they're ever going to allow that to happen, but, amazing times, right? But there's got to be, this one-world government in place. Well, how do you have a one-world government when you have a strong America or a strong Russia or a strong China? You can't have individual nations that won't give up their national sovereignty to join a global society unless conditions within those countries are so bad that they're looking for an alternative. Does it make sense? Start looking to how these pieces can come together, folks. And so we see man is working, unbelieving, unsaved man is working his plans, for the planet. Satan is using unbelieving man to advance his purposes for the planet. And all the while, God is sovereignly in control, working through all of those things. Absolutely incredible. And it's happening in our time. What do we do? A couple practical things here for you on this. First of all, we must reject the politics of division. I mean reject it, and I mean with loud voices, folks. We must run away from that nonsense. Second of all, be aware of how much you are influenced by the media and by culture around you. And, folks, I'm telling you, there's propaganda on the right and on the left. Our allegiances primarily are not to political parties, but our allegiances are to the Word of God. Evaluate everything, not with an R or a D, but with a B, the Bible. Evaluate everything scripturally. Become biblical thinkers. Discern, folks. Discern by using the Word of God. Ask what's true of everything that comes to you. That's our job as believers. See people as those who need the gospel, not as enemies. Now, there are things we oppose. Absolutely, and we need to use our voice to speak out against those things where they contradict the scriptures, where they are untrue. And we see it coming, folks. We see it coming down the line. And the last thing is we need to be unified as a church. We need to be the ones that set the example. We need to be the ones that speak into the society and say, no, we're not falling for this garbage anymore. We're not getting on that train. All these issues are settled in the scriptures. They're all settled at the cross. And we're going to stand on that. That's going to bring unity back to the country if we come, to the scriptures and bow our knee before the Lord Jesus. That's our message. We need to be discerning because this war is here. Oh, but, Pastor, it's going to turn around. The ship is going to right itself. Really? Do you know that? I don't know that. I mean, I hope so. But I don't know. I don't have a crystal ball. I can't look in the future and see. But I'll tell you this, all these ideas are coming into the church too. You see preacher after preacher now saying that the gospel that you believed, that the gospel you've been taught is a white gospel. Now what the heck does that even mean? A white gospel? It's a white European gospel. That's funny. What nationality was Jesus and Paul and all the other guys? Were they white? No, they were Jewish, Middle Eastern. I mean, it's nonsense, but it's coming, folks. It's here already. It's being shoved at you from every corner, and it will start to invade the church. It's already doing so. Be discerning. Get your eyes open. Know the scriptures. Now, second argument Jesus uses. He says this. He says, now if I drive out demons by Beelzebub, by whom do your followers drive them out? So then they will be your judges. So let me get this straight, guys, right? So your exorcists are driving out demons by the power of God, but I'm doing it by the power of Satan? Nah, that's totally inconsistent. Not only is your argument absurd, but it's inconsistent with your own exorcists. They're doing it by the power of God. I'm doing it by the power of God. Look at the last statement, verse 20. But if I drive out demons by the finger of God, then the kingdom of God has come to you. See that? It's come upon you. That's pretty incredible language. Whenever you see an expression, something like that, like the finger of God, you say, well, where have I saw that before? Where have I read about that before in Scripture? First of all, we see that that whole expression is there in the giving of the Ten Commandments, where they were, you know, written by the finger of God. But it's also in the story of the Exodus. Now, in the story of the Exodus, we have, you mean the charlatan, you mean the fake, you know, miracle workers, the Egyptian, you know, magicians, right? And by the way, they had some power. They had some power to do some pretty crazy things. Where'd they get that power? From Satan. But, you know, in the story, you know, God tells Aaron, take your staff, slam it into the dust, and all the dust in Egypt will become gnats. Those little flies, maybe biting flies like you find down on the shore, them greenhead nightmares. You know what I'm talking about? Man. Now, if you ever gone out in the summertime, you spend any time even outside, those little, you know, things that fly around your face, how annoying are they, right? Can you imagine? You mean like this, you know, thousands upon millions of those things, you know, flying around the entire land, and the torture that must have been. So, you know, Pharaoh's like, well, hey guys, you know, can you magicians, can you guys do this? And they try, but you know what they say back to Pharaoh? No, this was done by the finger of God. Exodus 8:19. It's done by the finger of God. That's the context that Jesus has in mind. That these miracles I do, they're not done by the power of Beelzebub. They're done by the very finger of God. And since that is evident, the conclusion that you are to draw is that the kingdom of God has come upon you. Now, it's about to get real. You guys okay? You guys all right? I haven't put you to sleep yet, have I? Because it's going to get real right here. Now, I want you to pay attention. Don't miss this, folks. This is some blow-your-mind stuff. This is some awesome, rejoice, like celebrate, you know, cool stuff here. Here it is, verse 21. He's going to give an illustration here. Now, when a strong man, fully armed, guards his own house, his possessions are safe. But when someone stronger attacks and overpowers him, he takes away the armor in which the man trusted and divides up his plunder. Now, what's the deal with this illustration? He's talking about the casting out of demons, and he gives this illustration. How do these two fit together? Again, start to use the reasoning. What does the name Beelzebub mean? Lord of the house. Right? When a strong man, fully armed, guards his own house. Who's the strong man here? It's not Jesus. This is the devil. This is the Lord of the house. This is Beelzebub, right? You mean the temporary, one, you mean in charge of the affairs, you mean of the world. The one who is in charge over the world system right now. When the strong man, fully armed, guards his own house, his possessions are safe. What do you think his possessions are? Those are the souls of men and women who are apart from Jesus Christ. That's his possessions. They're his. He dominates them. He enslaves them. I mean, he causes them to sin and then join with him in his rebellion against God and ultimately takes them to hell with him. That's Satan's. Those are his possessions. And he feels safe. Oh. Nobody can touch me. I'm in charge here. I got all these people under my power. Uh-oh, but verse 22. Uh-oh. But when someone stronger, who do you think that someone stronger is? That's the Lord of hosts. That's the God of angel armies. That's the true Lord over all the universe. But when someone stronger attacks and overpowers him, he takes away the armor in which the man trusted and divides up his plunder. You see, Jesus came to rescue sinners out of the hands of Satan, to take them and become his possession. We know we read in Colossians chapter 1, you mean in verse 13, that he rescued us by a mighty act of deliverance. That's what that word rescue means. He rescued us from the dominion of darkness and translated us into the kingdom of his Son in whom he loves. That's what happened the moment you came to know Christ. You switched kingdoms. You got on the victor's side in the war of the worlds. So if you ask for the Pastor Jeff translation, that you look at how this whole story and illustration is working, is that, you know, Jesus left him in the throne room of heaven, you know, walked right into Satan's house, kicked his butt, and took his stuff. That's what happened, folks. That's what happened. That's what happened. That's pretty amazing. Because he's the strong one. Because he's the true ruler of all creation. Now, get this. The miracles of Jesus displayed the coming of God's kingdom and power. You understand that? Does that make sense to you? Now, when we see the miracles of Jesus and what he performed during that time, and we saw his work on the cross, we look forward to greater power and to greater authority in that kingdom that is coming. I mean, it is yet future to us today. Remember that although Satan has temporary ownership over this world, it doesn't ultimately belong to him. He's a usurper, and one day he's going to get his rear end kicked out of this place. Don't forget that. Second of all, Satan's power has been forever broken on the cross. And he is in the process of being defeated. Make sure you get that. Make sure you pay attention to that language I used. I chose that language carefully. That on the cross, all the power of hell was forever broken. There is no person who desires to come to Jesus Christ that cannot, because Satan will not let him. His power is not that great. There is no sin that has you in bondage and enslaved, I mean right now, that Christ cannot set you free from. All the power of hell has been broken on the cross through his death, burial, and resurrection. Can you imagine that day when Christ came up out of that grave and Satan sitting there going, uh-oh, didn't see that one coming. Satan's not omniscient. He doesn't know all things. Can you imagine that day when up out of the grave he came and the victory was assured? And day by day, he's in the process of being defeated. He's being defeated by us. When we stand in the name of Jesus and refuse to do what is wrong, when we rely on the power of the Holy Spirit who works so mightily in us, and we say, God, we're going to be obedient to you. We're going to throw off Satan's schemes. We're going to resist the devil, and he's going to flee from us. And day after day, as the world history goes on, more and more we're advancing in God's plan towards his ultimate consummation. That's the third point. That the universal rule of God over the earth has begun, and it began when Jesus came. That's when his rule began. That's when the kingdom of God had come. Remember, he said, it's upon you now. And it says this, and will be consummated when Christ returns in the second coming. That's that event that Nick talked about. What that would be like, I mean, for people in the world. All of a sudden, seeing the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, as described in the end of the book of Revelation, coming on a white horse, the sky, heavens open. He's got a robe, looked like it's been dipped in blood. And on his thigh, a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and a double-edged sword that comes out of his mouth with which to slay the heaven, and the men on the earth, his enemies. And by the way, who comes with him? It says, all the hosts of heaven. The angelic armies, I believe the saints of God, you and I, the church age saints, going to come back with them at that time. Can you imagine being someone who has so hated God, so opposed God, and all of a sudden on that moment the heavens open? One day God's universal rule over the earth will be consummated when Christ takes back this world from Satan, locks him into the bottomless pit for 1,000 years, and then ultimately after he's loose for a short season, cast them into the lake of fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. That's incredible, incredible stuff. Now, we just have a little bit longer here to go. I got to get you to see this. Verse 23, on the heels of that discussion, Jesus says this, whoever is not with me is against me. And whoever does not gather with me scatters. We see statements like this from Jesus, I mean, all through the New Testament, all through the Bible. We see, you know, back in Joshua, choose this day whom you will serve. We see in the book of Proverbs, there are only two paths. There's the path of folly and the path of wisdom. We see Jesus in his statement, no one can serve two masters. He's going to love one or hate the other. We see that the battle lines have been drawn since the beginning of creation. And let me be plain. There is no such thing as sitting on the sidelines. No such thing as sitting on the sidelines. There is no Switzerland option. We're just going to remain neutral. God doesn't leave us that choice. There is no middle ground. There is no compromise. There is no remaining neutral. It's going to be one or the other. And Jesus says, in essence, if you're not with me, then you might as well act as if you're against me. And if you're not gathering with me, then you might as well be scattering. It's an absolute statement. And by the way, the world has that same standard. You know, there were many Christians, I mean, for a time, even in this country, who believed, well, I know things are getting worse, but you mean, you know, pretty much leave the church alone, and you mean the church, you can just be in your church, and they're going to be out there, and we'll just live in, you know, two separate worlds here, you mean, and that's going to be fine. But oh, that's not what we see happening, is it? No, it's not enough just to, you know, accept these things and, like, just be tolerant of everyone, right? Guess who the only person is you can't be tolerant of now? It's going to be the Christian. That's coming real soon. I mean, and you see it. I mean, the world isn't going to allow you to remain neutral. The world is going to shove you into a corner. We see it more and more. It's going to shove you into a corner on gender. Are there really two genders, male and female? He created them, or is that wrong? He's going to shove you into a corner on sexuality. Is homosexuality really a sin as the Bible presents, or isn't it? That's a question. We need to wrestle with that. What does the Bible say? It's pretty darn clear. You're going to be divided into the vaccinated and the unvaccinated. You're not going to be able to do this. They passed, you know, laws up in New York, right? That you're not going to be able to go to a restaurant, not be able to go to a gym, not be able to do anything if you don't have, you know, a vaccination. Why, my goodness, maybe some of us might have to get some Jewish stars, you know, some gold Jewish stars like they did in World War II and put unvaccinated on and walk around like that. We have some kind of vaccine apartheid, you know, going on, I mean, in our very own country. It's madness, it's folly, it's foolishness. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not against vaccine. If you want to get a vaccine, that's your business. That's your job. You think about it. You pray about it. You consult your medical, you know, physicians and make a decision that's right for you. But man, forcing somebody to do something by government fiat? Not in my book. Not in my book. That's wrong road. The government has the power to do that. What else does the government have the power to do? And little by little, we secede our freedoms. And little by little, ground is taken away. I mean, even right now, how can you be in a public school if you're a Christian teacher in some areas of the country when they're demanding that you teach, you know, a critical race theory to students that basically divides, I mean, people along race? How can you do that in good conscience as a Christian? How can you in good conscience as a Christian teach that there are more than one gender? That you mean that all this other stuff they're throwing out there? These are issues that are fundamental to the Christian faith. We're being continually shoved out of society, ostracized, shamed, hated, eventually persecuted. And I was amazed that folks that walk around with surveys, in our cities today and say, do you think that people who haven't received a vaccine should be jailed and sent to prison for that? And they're signing up. Yes, I do. I believe that. What? We've lost our collective gourd. We're out of our minds in this country. But that's what happens when you ignore the truth of God. You replace it with all kinds of foolishness. The world is giving you no quarter. And so we talked about that during this time that there's going to have to be a choosing of the church. The church is going to have to decide. You can't remain neutral anymore. Pick a side, folks, and jump in with both feet because the middle ground is being taken away each and every day. Now, last thing, Jesus finishes this passage up with this another illustration here. When an impure spirit comes out of a person, it goes through arid places seeking rest and does not find it. And then it says, I will return to the house I left. And when it arrives, it founds the house swept clean and put in order. And And then it goes and takes seven other spirits, demons, more wicked than itself, and they go in and live there. And the final condition of that person is worse than the first. Now, what is this all about? Like, well, how does this relate to the rest of the passage? Well, you mean, he just got done talking about neutrality, and this is an illustration about the dangers of neutrality. Think about it. Here's this guy, this man, standing probably close to Jesus when he's talking to the crowd. He's just been delivered from demonic possession. His house is in order. The demon has left. But if he doesn't fill up that space in his heart and in his life with the Lord Jesus Christ, then it is possible that that same demon that was cast out could come back and bring seven of his friends who are more wicked than it, and the final wretched condition of that man could be worse than it was when Jesus first met him. That's the illustration. Does it make sense to you? Don't remain neutral. You can't do that. You've got to make a decision for Christ. You've got to fill that empty, unbelieving heart with Jesus, or you're going to be in a worse condition. There's a worse fate available, a worse fate coming. That's his message. It's fantastic. It's phenomenal. It's amazing. And it's a great warning to us. What happens to me the moment that I reach out to Jesus and I say, Lord, I acknowledge that I'm a sinner before you, that I can't save myself, that I'm not a good person, as the world tells me, that I'm in need of your salvation, that I'm in need of your blood shed for me. Lord, would you save me from my sin? What happens at that moment? Who comes to reside inside of you? It's the Holy Spirit that comes to reside inside of you. What does the scripture say about the Holy Spirit in me? Greater is he who is in you than he that is what? In the world. Who's he that is in the world? That's Satan. I got the strongest man living inside me as the Lord Jesus, and there ain't no demon that can occupy that same space if Christ is in my life, if the Holy Spirit is in my life, because the stronger man is there, and I'm his possession forever and ever, settled, done deal, right? That's it. That's what he's talking about here. That's why the illustration is great. Decide now. Choose. Because a worse fate could await you. Now, let's end this with a couple points here. If you think that you can just go along and get along, you are sadly mistaken. God doesn't offer that option to you, and neither does the world. And that's becoming increasingly clear. Folks, a time of choosing is upon us. Are you going to get in the battle? Are you going to take part in the war of the world? How do I do that? Number one, take a stand for what is right. Though all the world, though everyone in your company, though every one of your friends, though every one of the folks in your school, though all the political voices and all the social media influencers are telling you something that is clearly not wrong or clearly wrong, take a stand, folks. Don't be ashamed to name the name of Christ. If you're still thinking that you're going to be Mr. Popular and be a Christian, abandon that notion. Throw yourself fully on the Lord. Find the comfort of the body of Christ in unity and like-minded individuals. And let go of the rest of that nonsense. Stand for the truth. Talk to your friends and your neighbors about the truth. Look for people that need the gospel of Jesus Christ. Tell them. Use your opportunity to vote. Go to meetings, school board meetings, teachers' meetings. Let your voice be heard. There are things that we can do. We don't just sit back. But oh, it's time to pick a side. The final thing, because a heart divided against itself cannot stand either. A divided heart does not work. James says that a double-minded man is what? Unstable in everything that he does. There's no possible way to live with one foot in the world and one foot in God's kingdom. What that is none other than cowardice. Turn away from the world's nonsense. Embrace the crucified one. Go outside the city to him and join him in being among the hated the persecuted and the unintelligent and the unenlightened and all the uns that we throw on people. And where so many would see that as a mark of shame, you know what we see that as? We see that as a mark of honor. That we would suffer for him who suffered so much for us. Amen? Time to choose, folks. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you again for this day. Thank you, Lord, for your wonderful love for us. Thank you for Jesus, who bore the shame, who bore the humiliation of sins he never committed under the cross of Calvary so that he might destroy the devil's works. So he might go into the strong man's house and take his possessions. Lord, I thank you that you rescued me from the dominion of darkness. That many here in this auditorium who name the name of Christ are thankful that you rescued them from the dominion of darkness. Father, if there's one person here who hasn't chosen sides yet, who hasn't made that decision to follow you, Lord, that they would recognize that you are a wonderful Savior, a gracious Lord, will come and find that forgiveness of sins, open their heart to you and be saved. Lord, give us courage as we stand against the darkness in this world. We know who this world system is under the control of, Lord. We know that. We have our eyes open. Lord, help us have the courage to be willing to join in the shame of the Savior, that one day it is coming, we might be exalted. Lord, how we love you this morning. How we are so thankful that you're a part of our life. Father, again, give us courage in Jesus' name. All God's people said, amen.
As we sing this final song, I just have a simple question. The one we're singing about. Do you know him or do you defy him? There's grace for us all. Please stand as we sing Authority.
Creation knows the voice that spoke into the void, the breath that brought the dust to life and sang the stars to form. The darkness fears his voice that drove it back before. And though the night is long, I know your light will drive it back once more. One word from you, things changed on your authority. Your word is true, things changed on your authority. My fight is not my own. Its end is in your hands. I worship you because I know all things must bow to your command. One word. Things change on your authority. strongholds not be moved, will spirits not be silenced and cower at his rule. For if my God is for me, then what have I to fear? And I will not deny him the glory that is his.
Let's sing it again.
Heaven will prevail.
Do you believe that?
And strongholds will be moved. Spirits will be silenced and cower at his rule. I know my God is for me, so what have I to fear? For nothing will deny the glory that is his. One word from you, things change by your authority. Your word is true. Things change. Silence and cower at his rule. I know my God is for me, so what have I to fear? But nothing will deny the glory that is his. One word from you, things change.
Father, as we close today, remember that you're the authority, you're the Lord of hosts, even after we leave these doors. This is not something just to be reminded of when we're together, to put on some show, to make us all feel like we're part of something special, but to know, to believe that we are part of something that is eternal and holy and set apart and lasts beyond this world. And the very Lord of hosts who spoke to that demon, the very one who had to argue for his own validity, he's the one who is coming back, and we'll meet him in the clouds, and we will be changed, and we will be with him forever. We look forward to that, knowing that his promises are true, and what you said will indeed happen. Your word does not return void. If you've said it, it happens. So we can trust in you with true faith, faith that comes from you. May the Lord bless you and keep you and cause his face to shine upon you, be gracious unto you, and give you peace. In Jesus' name, amen. Go in peace, but on your way out, make sure you wish my mom a happy birthday. 39 and holding.
Come behold the works of God.